Hello, my name is Brad Crompton. I'm the Assistant Wildlife Manager in the Southeast Region. I've been asked to present this presentation on management bison hunts specific to the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. Today, we'll be asking the Wildlife Board to consider the following two items to approve. First of all, it's rule changes to R657-5-38 and R657-62-8 that allow for an over-the-counter bison hunting opportunity to occur. And then, more specifically, to allow this sort of opportunity to occur beginning this fall on the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. The bulk of this presentation is really about the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit, and we'll go over the details of these rule changes toward the end of this presentation. Just a little bit on the history and the justification for this recommendation. The map on your right is a map of the greater Book Cliffs area. The orange area in the center is the Uinta and Ouray Indian Reservation. The circle in the center denotes a large bison population that has grown over time. And these bison, about 10 to 12 years ago, began migrating off the reservation west across the Green River to the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. And when they do these migrations, it's often several hundred bison that show up on the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. Now the three green arrows going north and east and south are migrations that occur onto the Book Cliffs Unit, where we have an established bison management plan and a population objective. We have a means to control these migrations and manage these populations. We transplanted bison to the Book Cliffs a number of years ago. And there's a way to deal with these bison. However, the red arrow moving west onto the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit is a bit different. There is no established bison management plan on the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit, so hence the population objective is zero. And furthermore, it's very remote and rugged, and a bunch of other challenges that come up with this. So this is what it looks like on the ground. Once again, the pink on the left is a map of the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. And on the right is our reservation lands. All these little dots are GPS locations of a number of bison that were captured several years ago, and it's a daily location over the course of a full year. You'll note the bison spend most of the summer months on the reservation lands, and the fall and winter move to this isolated corner of the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit. And the point of this slide really is to show that they're not everywhere on the unit. They're really in two fairly remote canyons on a corner of the unit. And there are some significant issues associated with that. So these are the challenges the Division of Wildlife faces in this issue. Is, first of all, that the Division of Wildlife does not have management authority most of the year because these bison reside on tribal lands throughout the summer and most of the fall. Furthermore, the Ute tribe has a very strong connection to these bison. They're rounded up. They feel they're their bison, even when they migrate off of tribal lands. With bison being a relatively new species on the landscape on the Nine Mile Range Creek Unit, private landowners and public land grazers have concerns over bison grazing on their allotments, and also the potential risk of disease transmission from bison to cattle. So these cause some concerns as well. I also want to paint a picture of how rugged and remote this country is. The pictures on your right denote some of the country that these bison often reside in. It is extremely rugged, remote, and roadless terrain. Access to a couple of these areas is only via Desolation Canyon, which is an 84-mile float. It takes 4 days usually to float that and requires a permit from the BLM, so it's relatively difficult to get a hold of. The other portion of this unit in Range Creek itself is accessed via a high mountain pass where you pass over 8,500 feet. So once the snow begins to fly, it's rather difficult to drive over this pass, and you can't access it relatively early in the winter. Furthermore, once you get there, the Utah Museum of Natural History controls a large portion of Range Creek itself, and there's no vehicle access along there. And there's only a restricted amount of walk-in or horseback-only access permits allowed, and no access at all after December 1st. So this creates a very narrow window of opportunity for public hunters to access a bison, basically from mid-October, when bison typically arrive, until the snow flies or December 1st. This is what it looks like on a map. The circle on the upper right is the Desolation Canyon portion. A bunch of bison are residing there in the winter months, but it takes a four-day float trip to get there and a permit from the BLM. The yellow polygon on the left denotes the Range Creek area that is walk-in access only, owned by the Natural History Museum of Utah, and no public access after December 1st. And you see most of the bison reside in these areas, which complicate access issues. So in the past, we've done a number of measures to try to control this population. This wildlife board mandated the 9 Mile Range Creek Bison Committee that was formed a number of years ago. We've met, and it's quite a diverse group of individuals representing the Ute Tribe, the Museum of Natural History, the state of Utah, and public land grazers and private landowners, and quite a diverse group. And we didn't agree on everything, but one really solid thing that came out of this is very improved communication amongst all the partners in this committee. This recommendation we're presenting today is a product of this committee. Not everyone agreed on it, but it was a product of this committee. Another thing we've done in the past is we've used alternate hunters from the Bookcliffs draw list. So bison hunters that had put in for the Bookcliffs and did not draw, we called alternates from that list to hunt bison once they arrived on the Range Creek unit. We found this a very cumbersome process. Once we realized bison were in the area, we would begin to call these alternate hunters. They needed a few days to see if they could arrange their schedules and accept the permit. We needed to make sure they could get access permits and things like that. So it took sometimes a week to 10 days to get a hunter afield. And we were very slow. And it was also very labor intensive for DWR employees and all these phone calls. You have to go through a lot of people to get hunters for this. It was also very difficult to keep constant pressure on bison. It was usually just a couple hunters at a time, then a week or two without it, and then the weather would set in and we'd be done. And it was relatively ineffective as far as overall bison population control. We usually only harvest anywhere from 1 to 7 bison per year, so just putting a very small dent in the population. We've also constructed fences along key migration corridors intended to block migration onto this Range Creek unit. These fences have proven ineffective. Bison have found a way over, through, or around all of these fences. In very limited cases, the division has authorized limited helicopter hazing to push bison back to reservation lands. This has also been very ineffective as the GPS data shows that these bison often return to the Range Creek unit within 10 days. As I've noted in this slide presentation, there's a GPS study that started, so we can know kind of real time when bison are arriving on the unit, which has been very helpful. And because of the increased communication, the Ute Tribe has attempted to harvest a few more bison. They're fairly nominal permit increases on tribal lands at this point. So what we are proposing is a management bison hunt strategy that would require some rule changes. And what this would entail is that they'd be available online or at DWR offices. They'd be unlimited in nature. They'd be hunter's choice permits, meaning a person can harvest a cow or a bull bison. We would recommend a wide season framework from August 1st to January 31st. However, the bulk of the opportunity for sportsmen would be in late October and November, when most of these areas are accessible. The charge would be the full once-in-a-lifetime bison permit cost. And a key thing to point out is that hunters who purchase this permit will forfeit all their bison bonus points and will be ineligible to apply for the public draw. So it would take them, it would use up their bonus points. However, hunters can continue to purchase this permit on subsequent years as long as there's a need for hunt. There is no guarantee that this hunt lasts forever if it's effective at moving bison. Now, a key point in all this is education. So there would be a mandatory online training course required prior to purchasing this permit, just really outlining the extremely rugged, remote, and difficult situations that this hunt entails, and also defining that you'll lose your ability to apply for once-in-a-lifetime bison permits. And then just all the links to getting access permits through via the BLM or the Natural History Museum of Utah will be very important in this online training. What we hope to get from this hunt strategy is that we increase harvest and reduce bison in areas where with a population of objective of zero. In this case, it's the 9 Mile Range Creek unit. This also provides a very unique opportunity for hunters. And as such, you know, people who are up for this opportunity can have a very unique experience. And in the process that we remove, these people that opt for this option are out of the once-in-a-lifetime bison hunter pool, which helps things along as well. Now, this does require a few rule changes. Much of the things I defined in our recommendation require rule changes in R657-5-38. In subsection 7, it talks about defining what a bison management hunt is, and they can be established by the Wildlife Board on any unit where the bison population objective is zero. Today, we're only talking about the 9 Mile Range Creek unit, but it could apply to other units in the future. People who apply for this or purchase this permit forfeit their bonus points, but they may purchase them in subsequent years. They can harvest a blower cow, and they must take the mandatory online orientation course. Then R657-62-8 just refers back to this forfeiture of bonus points. So there's a slight amendment in that rule as well. And with that, if you have any comments or questions, please refer to the instructions below.